Hello, and welcome from Venice. I'll go into a bit later on why I'm filming from here. But in this video, we're going to start talking about another view on where competitive advantage comes from. It's called the resource-based view. If you remember, we went back to the beginning of the module. We talked about how different theorists about strategy made these different assumptions about where competitive advantage came from. Did it come from the activities the firm did or the resources it possessed? And also a different view about whether or not that competitive advantage was constant over time or whether there was a more dynamic process involved. Now, in this view on strategy, we are concentrating in the top left of this graph. So around unique resources that are not easily obtained being the source of competitive advantage. Now, the basic underpinning of this theory is that the firm is made up of a collection of resources, and it's the deployment of those resources to exploit a market opportunity that leads to the success of a firm. So, organisation made up of lots and lots of resources that give it the ability to do things. Now, I do want to stress here that when using this theory, the focus needs to be on resources. Don't mix up activities with resources. It's the stock of assets, skills, the qualities that can be drawn on when required that we're looking at. Don't worry about the fact that you're ignoring the activities the firm does, or its strategies, or moves it makes. That will pick up with other theories. So focus in on to the resources the firm possesses. Now, resources and activities are linked together. By performing activities, the firm gains resources. You do advertising, and over time, that advertising and other marketing activities build up into, you hope, a brand and brand loyalty. You do quality control. Quality control is an activity. Over time, you gain, if that quality control is successful, you gain a reputation for quality, a resource. You do R&D. Perhaps if you're Canon, you do R&D in optics. Over time, that builds into optics know-how. So unlike Porter's view of strategy, where you're focusing on those activities of advertising, quality control, R&D, for the resource-based view, you're focusing onto those resources the firm has, the brand loyalty, reputation for quality, optics know-how, etc., etc. Now, resources can be divided up into different sorts. Resources can be tangible, and these are things that you would often see on a firm's balance sheet. Things like its warehousing, its plant and machinery, its production capacity it has, the ownership of sources of raw materials, IT systems, tangible resources, or assets we might call them. Resources can also be intangible. They can be relational. They can be perhaps that relationship with a key customer or a major supplier or amongst the management team of an organization. Another important type of asset is knowledge. Now, specialist know-how in optics, as we talked about earlier, or organizational knowledge, both information, data, but also know-how that's contained within the routines, the processes, the culture and the norms of the firm. Now, only some resources can provide competitive advantage. They have to be different from what other firms have, otherwise all firms can do the same things. So perhaps strategic assets, we might like to call them. Now, the resources that will give competitive advantage will fit these three definitions. Firstly, resource heterogeneity. Now, this is simply a long way that economists use to say that they're different. They have to be specific resources that the firm has that others don't. Also, those resources have to generate an economic rent. So in its ownership, the firm gains a profit from those scarce resources. So perhaps it means customers come to that firm for what it can do as a result of having those resources. And finally, resource immobility. It simply means it is difficult for other firms to acquire or develop the same resources. They're just not purchasable in a marketplace. This is very different from what Michael Porter believes, whereby there is a market for resources, therefore the cost of acquiring or developing resources will reflect their value. And so there's no long-term gain to the organisation from having the resources. What RBV theory is saying is there are imperfections in that market for resources, and therefore there is additional value to be had from possessing those resources. Therefore, managers' role is to build strategies around those unique and valuable resources that the firm possesses, and so find areas where those resources can be exploited. So this is an inside-out perspective on strategy, that you look at what you have internally in the organisation, then you look externally about how you can exploit those resources. So again, different from Porter here, where Porter is saying you understand the external environment first and then align the business to gain advantage in those opportunities that you spot. Now, in terms of which resources might give you advantage, well, looking at tangible resources, it is unlikely that these resources are going to be immobile. Typically, for tangible resources, there is a market available to acquire those resources. Or you can simply buy in that resource, take it apart, and copy it. So the individual resources or assets that will tend to give advantage will be those intangible relationships, and also the knowledge assets of the organisation. In particular, the know-how that is held by the organisation in its routines and processes. However, there is a debate about whether or not individual resources alone, individual assets alone, can give a sustainable competitive advantage. Even for organisational know-how and relationships, they are imitable by other organisations. So theorists like Prahalad and Hamel go further. They say that rather than competitive advantage coming from individual resources, it comes from competencies or bundles of resources where individual assets are operating together to allow the firm to do something that others can't. So rather than being individual resources, it is several individual assets working together that create a competency, and it's the possession of those competencies that gives the firm the potential to have sustainable competitive advantage. Now, competencies you do need to see as integrated bundles of resources. These are resources that are working together in an integrated way to allow the firm to do something, so that the sum of those resources together is worth more than they would be individually. So they're really bound together. Now, in this, there are some different emphasis applied by different theorists. Some theorists concentrate on being an integrated bundle of resources. Others concentrate on the ability to integrate the resources together. These are two different ways to see the same thing. They are still, from both perspectives, we are still talking about a resource. A bundle of resources is still a resource. The capability to integrate those individual resources together is still a resource. So you're still focusing on to resources. Take, for example, on why Venice, while for tourists choosing to go to Italy, Venice is a major attraction. But it is not just one thing. It is the integration together of the famous sites, the Doge's Palace, St Mark's Square, the Rialto Bridge, the gondolas, the capability in glass blowing, where tourists will go and watch glass being made, perhaps Harry's Bar, and the general atmosphere and views that you get from Venice. All things that Venice possesses that attract tourists to there. Now you can take individual items out of Venice. You could put a gondola in the Thames. You could build a cathedral. You could open a Harry's Bar somewhere else. But it is the working together of these resources in Venice that make tourists want to visit this city. So let's just look at how those competencies drive competitive advantage. Well, the competencies allow the firm to do something that customers choose to come to the firm for. So the competencies give the firm a strategic capability, the ability to undertake a task for task that customers value, whether it's building low-priced cars, or transporting frozen items, or doing low-cost retailing. The advantage is provided not by doing those things, but by the possession of the competencies in the firm. And then that strategic capability allows the firm to target multiple market opportunities. So here another difference from Porter, where Porter is saying that you choose which market position you adopt. So choosing one product or service market, aligning the strategic business unit to that opportunity. Here we're saying those competencies, the roots of the organization, allow the firm to exploit opportunities across a wide range of markets. Let's have a quick look at an example. Now most of you, I expect, won't know what this is, but it's a steel print band. And several decades ago, it would have been used in high-speed printing. And so this is before laser printers and ink drop printers. So these steel bands would be put into large-scale printers and they'd whirl round and round and they'd create the characters on the paper going through the printer. Now Grace Manufacturing was a leading company in the production of steel print bands. It was founded in 1967 in Arkansas in the US. Now these print bands are very thin and they have to be very accurately engineered to get the detail needed onto that steel. But the company faced a decline in sales. With laser printers coming on replacing high-speed line printers, the company's future looks bleak. So if you link that back to our model of where competitive advantage comes from, well, the end product market that the company was serving was line printer manufacturers or end customers who needed replacement print bands. And so Grace Manufacturing had a strategic capability in the provision of great printer bands. It was very good at what it did. And to allow it to do that, it had competencies in a number of areas. In particular, know-how in what's called masking and photo etching, the process by which you produce that detail onto thin print bands. It also had print band manufacturer competency and a relationship with the printer manufacturing companies. And I'm sure it had many other competencies. But of course, with the replacement of line printers, the market for print bands was disappearing. And therefore, this strategic capability in the production of great print bands was becoming obsolete. And with that, competencies around print band manufacturing and that relationship with print companies was also ceasing to be valuable. So Grace Manufacturing started to look around for opportunities that would mean the survival of the organization. And it saw that in its abilities, this masking and photo etching know-how could be used in other ways. Now the company believed that in its ability in putting detail onto very thin steel meant there was other opportunities it could look to develop. Now if you worked in Grace Manufacturing, there was a saying that it wasn't a case of if you cut your fingers on this very thin steel, it was when you would cut your fingers. And looking at this prompted Grace Manufacturing to decide that there was a potential for them to develop very sharp tools. So they decided, with some research, to move into woodworking tools. And so they set about designing a set of tools for professional woodworkers and high-end DIY market, and produced this tool, a rasp for shaping wood. And so they began manufacturing under the brand of Microplane and started to sell to the DIY and professional woodworking market. Then they started getting reports that this tool was starting to be used rather than in woodworking, but in kitchens to grate cheese or carrots or such like. And to start with, Grace Manufacturing thing, hang on, this is not good for our brand. We're a professional woodworking tool company. And our emphasis needs to be onto that market segment. But as time went on, this use in the kitchen grew and the Microplane tool started to appear on various famous cooking programs with Martha Stewart recommending getting hold of this woodworking tool to use for grating items. And with this, Grace Manufacturing decided that this was a market they should be exploiting. So as well as woodworking tools, Grace Manufacturing moved into kitchen tool manufacturing. Both woodworking and kitchen tools rely on this strategic capability for provision of very sharp tools. And with that, additional competencies had to be developed. They already had this ability through masking and photo etching know-how to work with very thin steel with the detail required. But they had to also develop tool manufacturing competency. And also, as we're now talking about a consumer market, also look at how they brand their products. And I'm sure having to develop additional competencies, perhaps in their relationships with a very different distribution channel. And this is the tool that they produced in the kitchen industry, called the Microplane. And if you go into any high-end kitchen shop or department store, you'll see whole banks of these tools of different shapes and sizes of the detail on the cutting edge of the tool. And it is now the biggest selling kitchen tool of its type in the world. But Grace Manufacturing has also looked to exploit other product markets. So moving into personal care with a file for getting hard skin off your feet. You will notice it is still in the plastic wrapper, so I haven't been using this. So the competencies being the source of the firm's success, allowing the firm to have a strategic capability in sharp tools and then allowing it to operate across multiple different markets in a way very different to what we saw in the strategy as choice perspective developed by Michael Porter. So just to sum up this section, competitive advantage results from the firm's possession of unique and immobile resources. In that advantage, competitive advantage comes from within the firm. In that, management role is to seek opportunities that leverage that advantage. Now, bundles of resources or competencies are more likely to be unique and difficult for others to copy, so are more likely to confer competitive advantage. But firms are only likely to possess a small number of competencies or core competencies that will truly provide advantage. Even the most successful organizations probably will have less than five really core competencies. Now, identifying competencies is not always straightforward, and then you need to test whether or not individual competencies do provide competitive advantage, and so are core competencies. And how we do that is the topic of the next video.